They are a Carolina Coast icon. Their scientific name, Uniola paniculata. But to most of us, they're simply known as sea oats. They get that name from the tassel of oat-looking seeds that adorn the tips of the plant. For a lot of us, they are simply beautiful. To others, they are much more.
A sea oat is one of the few species of plants that can grow very close to the beach.
The most important plant along the coast.
It's critical for rebuilding the sand dunes.
Spencer Rogers is a coastal construction and erosion specialist with Sea Grant North Carolina, a marine research organization. Spencer co-authored the Dune Book, which provides in-depth information about dunes and dune vegetation.
To look at the advantages of the sea oats, their major advantage along the coast is they trap sand.
When you think of plants in erosion further inland, many people typically think of a plant's roots as holding soil together, stabilizing the soil, and controlling erosion. But that's not how sea oats work.
The biggest asset of the plants is that it traps windblown sand that's blowing off the dry beach in high winds when it gets to be maybe 25 miles per hour. The wind is going to blow sand off the dry sections of beach, and it's trapped by these stems and root systems.
So it's not the roots, but the sand trapping capacity along the base of sea oats that allows sand to build up.
As soon as the wind started blowing, we would see it starting to trap sand.
And as a result, dunes form.
Dunes are our primary protection from the bigger storm events. The more sand between you and the ocean in a hurricane, the more protection you have, and the longer it takes to wash away. So if the dune's big enough, it never makes it to the house.
Oh, and all those fences you see out along the coast?
The sand fence is just a man-made version of the wind trap created by the stems of the sea oats. So all you have to do to trap sand is slow down the wind in the first 6 inches above the surface, and both the stems and the slats in the sand fence do that quite nicely.
But sand fences last only a few years, while sea oats can last indefinitely. And that's something else considering the environment they grow in, harsh and extreme, one that would kill almost anything else.
That would be the temperature. It can get to be over 140 degrees on the sand surface. There's very little nutrients in the sand, so there's not much to encourage the plant to grow. It's constantly getting burial, which kills most plants. And the surface sands are very, very dry, so there's not much water out here either. This plant just loves it.
In other words, the sea oat is truly a super plant. That is, as long as it's on the coast.
It's a super plant for right here. What it doesn't do is compete well. You can carry this back to Charlotte and grow it in your front yard, but it doesn't compete well with the rest of the stuff in your yard, so it'll eventually die off. It just doesn't like crowded conditions and competition. Out here, it has no real competition to speak of. It thrives on its own.
People do try to grow sea oats outside the coast, taking them from their natural environment and transplanting them elsewhere. Now, there is no North Carolina law that explicitly protects sea oats, but many local ordinances do.
People visiting the beach should enjoy the beach, but stay off the vegetation. Use the walkways to and from the beach where they're available, and don't trample the edge of the vegetation because that's what's recreating the dunes.
As important as sea oats are to both the North and South Carolina coasts, you may be surprised to learn they are not an official symbol of either state, which have designated other plants as state symbols. Still, sea oats do hold a special place in the hearts and minds of so many. Their enduring beauty, part of what makes a trip to the ocean so appealing and visually stimulating. How could anyone possibly say otherwise when you see something like this, a painting only made possible by Mother Nature?